Welcome to Champlain Valley Unitarian Universalist Society. My name is Liam Battjes-Greenwood, and I have the privilege of helping with this service along with an amazing team of friends. Their names are in the bulletin. They help out with tech, music, flowers, in the kitchen, on stage. Thank you for all you do. But there are three names that aren't in the bulletin that I'd like to introduce you to. This is John John, and there's Bess right there, and what happened to Kai? Kai is down here, okay? And they are otherwise known as the band. We begin by acknowledging that we gather on land seized from the Western Abenaki people. And we say this every week. But we also have a Black Lives Matter banner hanging outside every week. Because we don't always know what to do to grow in justice and peace, but we do need daily reminders to grow in justice and peace. And as a community, we want to grow in justice and peace and work with our Abenaki neighbors and listen to their stories and their wisdom and their challenging voices. As a progressive community of faith, we strive to listen to as many voices as possible. And that's not easy work. It's not easy work. But Reverend Tricia Hart, who is leading our service, one of our contracted ministers, is reminding us today that living out our principles of justice and love and peace and listening to each other's voices, that's why we're here. She also said we're not here for long announcements, so I have to move on. Quickly touch on six events and tell you a little bit of a story. Today, you can connect with CVUUS by filling out our guest book if you're a guest. You can connect by filling out a yellow card if you have a milestone or passage you want to share aloud. You can also fill out a pink card if you have a milestone or passage in your life that you don't want to publicly announce, but you want to give us an opportunity to care for you. The ushers will help you find those cards, and you'll hear more about the pink ones. That's today. Wednesday, let's consider our obligations to respond to climate change by listening to Chuck Collins at Middlebury College's Dana Auditorium. And this Thursday, you could join me at Shiretown Market at 3:30 for lesson number three. From 7.5 lessons on the human brain, we will consider how economic disparity influences children's brain development. On Friday, CVUUS singles who are over 60, I wanted to include myself and put 50 in there, okay. Singles over 60 are doing coffee at Little Seed Coffee Shop. Saturday, if you know any Spanish, come and befriend our Hispanic neighbors as we host the Mexican consulate and support the migrant workers who help to feed us. Sunday, join the affordable housing conversation we're coordinating with other faith communities within Middlebury. It'll be at Middlebury UCC. It's a great follow-up to the very meaningful conversation Tom Morgan had this past week on the challenge of homelessness. That's just this week. Think about those announcements. What do you hear? What I hear are principles put in action. That's what I hear. This is the ministry of CVUUS. Oh, I just got choked up because I love it here. I love this community and all the good things that we strive to do and how we stumble over each other in the striving of how to do all these good things. And it's why I volunteered along with my husband, Mike, to support our Radical Love Exchange. The Radical Love Exchange, it promises to support a big chunk of our budget, and it's an important part of funding our shared ministry. but that's not why I volunteered, because I really don't like fundraisers. But I really like this one. I love the Radical Love Exchange because it doesn't just build up the budget, it builds up friendships. It builds up community. Yes, we'd like you to give financially. $10, $100, 10% of your pledge, whatever you can afford. But more importantly, give of yourself. Give of yourself by offering something to share. This is the Sunday to do it in person, or you have a few days more online. But also give of yourself by allowing others to share with you. Share a dinner. I grew up in West Michigan. I'm a Flatlander. A Flatlander, and with parents who were often flat broke. So I didn't ski when I was growing up. But I took these lessons, and with Hannah's patience guidance, I learned to bend my knee and negotiate a turn and come to a controlled stop with a snowplow rather than hit a tree. And I did this with a group of people who ranged in age from 8 to 80, who were also learning to ski. And we became better skiers, but more importantly, by chatting and falling and laughing and trying, we became better friends. So sign up today. Sign up today for what you might want to contribute to the Radical Love offering. You can contribute financially by putting a check in the offering plate, or it's available online. I'm really interested in how you can give and receive in ways that build up our community. One of my favorite parts of the service is when we stand and look at each other and say, "From you I receive, and to you I give." And together we share, and from this we live. This is how we live out those principles. It's radical. It's love.
Thank you, Liam. The call to worship this morning, you have probably heard before. It was written some years ago by Starhawk, who is one of our pagan Unitarian Universalist and beyond leaders. And it starts with the word community. Somewhere there are people to whom we can speak with passion without having the words catch in our throats. Somewhere a circle of hands will open to receive us. Eyes will light up as we enter. Voices will celebrate with us whenever we come into our power. Community means strength that joins our strength to do the work that needs to be done. Arms to hold us when we falter, a circle of healing, a circle of friends, someplace where we can be free. Would you light the chalice, please, Liam? Unitarian Universalist congregations do different things when they light their chalices. And many years ago, I was working with a congregation in Rhode Island that was trying to decide what their chalice lighting words would be. And in good democratic fashion, they said, "Well, let's have a series of experiments. Let's do this thing for a month, and then we'll do another thing, and then we'll do a third thing." And this thing I'm about to teach you was the first thing that they decided to try to say together at their chalice lighting. And when the month was up and I said, "Shall we try something else now?" they said, "Absolutely not. We like this." And I think they're still doing it. So it's a call and response. Here's how it goes. Just say back to me what I say. It is a blessing to be. It is a blessing to be here.
It is a blessing to be here.
It is a blessing to be here
now.
It is a blessing to be here now together.
It is a And let us light our chalice this morning in a spirit of love and hope for all of the people of Israel and Palestine and the world. Let's sing.
Come, whoever you are, and gather around to listen to a story. This is a story called Sophia's Guest. Once upon a time, there was a teacher named Sophia. Sophia had been a teacher in her town where she lived for so long that she was now teaching the kids of the kids she had taught years ago. Nearly everyone in the town knew Sophia, and not just because she was a teacher, but because she was very kind. So one day when Sophia came home from work, she found a note on her porch.
And the note read, "Dear Sophia, I will be around tomorrow. I wonder if I might stop by your house for tea tomorrow afternoon. Your friend, God."
At first, Sophia thought it was a joke. But the more she thought about it, the more she thought that if it were a joke, that was not really a very funny joke. Then she thought, what if it isn't a joke? What if God really was going to come to her house tomorrow afternoon? So she thought she better get ready, just in case. So she went to the store. And she bought one of those mats you put out in front of your door. The kind that says, "Welcome." Then she cleaned her house. From top to bottom, she brought in flowers from the garden. So she cleaned and got ready and moved things around and made everything sparkly and great, and then she went to bed. In the morning, Sophia realized that she didn't know what God liked to eat. God had mentioned tea, but that was it. So Sophia made bread and made a casserole and made fruit salad. She made sure that there was a vegan, gluten-free choice. She made some cookies. But what about tea? Tea had been mentioned, but what kind of tea? Hot tea, cold tea, peppermint tea? Sophia thought she better make both, thinking maybe tea with caffeine might be useful if you're God. But what if God liked lemonade, like didn't want to drink tea all the time? So she made some lemonade too, and she was just so nervous. She didn't know what to expect. She didn't really know about the timing. And just then, there was a knock at the door. Sophia's heart went pat, pat, pat. So she took a deep breath, and she opened the door. And on the other side was the mayor of the town.
Hello, Sophia. I was walking by and smelled the delicious fresh-baked bread.
Oh, I'm so glad you're here. Come in. I'm expecting a very important visitor that you actually might like to meet. Please come in and make yourself at home. So Sophia and the mayor sat for a while, had a nice discussion, and ate some bread, and then there was another knock at the door. So Sophia's heart went pat, pat, pat. She took a deep breath. She opened the door slowly. And then on the other side was some kids from her class.
Hello, Miss Sophia. We were walking by and noticed the smell of fresh baked cookies.
Well, I'm glad you're here, so come on in. I'm expecting a really important person that all of you actually might like to meet. And the mayor's here, so come on in. There's cookies and lemonade. Don't drink the tea in the white pot because it has caffeine in it and your parents will freak out and get mad at me. So the children were eating and talking with the mayor and giving the mayor a lot of advice about how things should be in the town when there was another knock on the door. Sophia's heart went pat, pat, pat. Deep breath. Open the door. It was the newly formed committee at her church that was going to decide how the bulletin board should be used.
Hello, Sophia. We heard the tea kettle and the laughter, and we thought you might be having a party.
Well, come on in. There's some kids here, and the mayor is here, and there's a lot of food, so help yourself. And I'm expecting a really, really important visitor who you might want to meet, so come in and make yourself at home. So all afternoon, people stopped by Sophia's house, lured by the yummy smells and the happy sounds, and there was singing. The townspeople filled her house upstairs and downstairs, and then they went into the backyard, and then they overflowed into the front yard and the sidewalk. And when they got hungry and had eaten everything they had, they all made spaghetti together, and they ate as the sun set and the moon came up. And it was such an amazing party. People were playing games and telling stories and playing charades and baking. There was Pictionary, they played music, they were talking. Sophia had such a nice time that she completely forgot about her very important guest who had said that they were gonna arrive. So even as she waved goodbye to all her friends at the end of the night, she felt only contentment at having had such a great party. The next morning, though, she woke up and remembered the letter. She was so confused. What had happened to God coming? So all during her work at school that day, she tried to figure out what had happened. She said hi to the kids and smiled at everybody, and on our way home, smiled at the mayor and saw committee people and came home and thought, that really was a great party. We should totally do that again sometime. When she got home, there was another note on her porch. So she opened it. And this one read,
"Dear Sophia, I had such a wonderful time yesterday. The bread was delicious, the cookies were divine, tea mixed with lemonade is my very favorite. Thank you for being such a wonderful host. I hope we can do it again soon. Love, God."
Yeah, exactly. What? Right, Sophia thought she knew who was gonna show up. I mean, kind of, when she imagined God showing up. But then all the people she knew showed up, and then God said they had showed up, so, I wonder how that story would have ended if Sophia had told everybody who came by and knocked on the door that they couldn't come in because Sophia was expecting God to come. Unitarian Universalism believes that we don't have to wait for God because God is here in all of us right now, and in the people on this planet who are not here right now. So, let's sing together. The song we're gonna sing is the beginning of the song by a group called Emma's Revolution. And the song is called Peace, Salam, Shalom, which are the words for peace in three different languages. Peace in English, salam, how you say peace in Arabic, shalom, how you see peace in Hebrew. So we will be singing just the start of the song, which is the repeat of those three words. And after a while, Michaela and I and any kids who are here are going to head out while you keep looping with the song a little bit until you get sick of it or Ronnie shuts you down. And we're gonna go actually make muffins for the Mexican consulate visit, which is this Saturday. And the last I checked, more food is needed. There's a sign-up sheet online. I'm hoping there's a link in the blast that came out. I'm sure there is somewhere. If you can't find it, just let me know and I'll let you know. But I think we still need food for that visit. We might need other things too. But this is definitely a way to be helpful to God and all of us and everyone. My t-shirt, by the way, is an Emma's Revolution t-shirt. Can't talk and show you the shirt at the same time, but it says peace, salam, shalom on it. Okay, so I encourage you as you sing to really sing from your heart. You can rise in body or spirit and really think about sending out your voice and your love and peace to the places, including yourself, that really need it. If you really just need it, sometime you might not even want to sing. You might just want to stand in the middle of us and take it in. All of that's fine. All right. I'm gonna sing two lines back to you. You sing it back to me. I'll sing the next two lines. You sing it back to me. Then you'll have it, and we'll just go into it. Peace, salam, shalom. 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 Peace, salam, shalom.
Peace, salam, shalom.
perhaps you have wondered why it is, given that there are lots of ways that you can donate money to the congregation without actually having to be here in person, you may have wondered why we do this, why we stop every week. We and every other Unitarian Universalist congregation that I know of stops in the middle of the service to take up a collection. And I think it's because we need to remember a couple of things. One is that the congregation exists. This congregation exists because of the vision and the generosity of its people, its members and friends here and not here. That may seem so obvious, we don't need to think about it very much, but really and truly, for those of us who, for example, like me, grew up Catholic or some other denomination where there were pots of money somewhere else, you never quite knew where, that's not Unitarian Universalism. Our congregations exist. Let me see. How does a new congregation ever happen within Unitarian Universalism? I bet some of you have a thought about how that happens. I bet some of you were actually involved in making that happen here. In Burlington, where I was most recently, it was way back in around 1799 that people decided that they wanted a congregation. But I loved telling stories about that time because it was the same impulse. We need a place to gather. We need something that we understand is religious. We don't all have to agree with each other, and we can argue about that just as much as we want, but we are going to make a thing that is sometimes called a church and sometimes called a society. That impulse, that determination, that dedication, it happened way back then, and it happens now too, and it is good to remember that people can make something important happen and then keep it going. It's also a way to remember that this congregation, like many congregations, can use some of the money that gets collected on a Sunday and give it away to organizations in the community that are doing the work that our principles and values tell us we must support. This is one of the easiest and most direct and most important ways that we do that. The donee for this month, you may know this already, is the Acorn Food Hub, which is part of the remarkable systems that exist, run by remarkable people in Middlebury and beyond, to make sure that that hunger is not an obstacle to living and health and community. So, your gifts today, your gifts at any time this month, will be shared with Acorn Food Hub and also with this congregation. So it actually matters that we believe in our own generosity and in one another's. This morning's offering will now be most gratefully received. live out our belief in this congregation in one another by donating and also by being together. So as Ronnie moves into your favorite song, and maybe before you start to sing it, would you rise in spirit and body and just look at each other and greet one another for a minute, and then we'll sing. Wonderful. I'd like to invite Catherine Schlaff up just for a moment to introduce the new pink cards.
And thank you, Liam. Thank you, Liam, for giving a little shout out to them this morning. So the Caring Network, of which I'm a member along with seven other people and our ministers, perhaps you know, or maybe you don't know, what we do. We have our eyes and ears tuned to the needs of our congregation of members and friends. And we do things like offer rides to a doctor appointment, create a group of people who will make meals for somebody who's coming home from the hospital, help with a move if you're moving somewhere, or even if you or somebody you know are lonely and could use a visit, we can connect people that way. You can find out how to contact us in the directory, but we've thought of another way that is another way that maybe we can find out what needs are out there that we're missing, and that are these pink cards. Say you're driving to church or even walking up the steps and you think of something that could be helpful to someone in our congregation or even yourself. So you can fill these out there in the foyer along with the yellow cards. And we have this envelope that you can put it in. It's confidential and we will check it every week and make those connections. Now it's not just us eight members and the ministers who serve the needs. With the survey that was done this spring, thank you so many of you who filled that out. Those were very helpful. We compiled a list of names of people who will make meals, who will offer rides, that sort of thing. So thank you very much. Stay in touch.
Thank you, Catherine. I'm going to read a yellow card from Neely Jennings, which says, "May all beings living in Palestine and Israel find safety, healing, and peace. Amen." And peace, and salam, and shalom. Would you just take a breath with me and one another? So we dream about peace and crave it, and sometimes we even know it in our own precious lives. War is what we worry about and fear and imagine and sometimes hear about in great detail because it is far too often a reality in human existence. Now is one of those times, as you know all too well. So what shall we do? I think our work as human beings and as Unitarian Universalists is much less about being right than it is about not turning away. I think at times like this, in addition to cultivating our skills at having nuanced conversations and opening our minds and hearts to the complexities and the tragedies of the situation right now in the Middle East, in Israel and Gaza and all of Palestine and the other countries there as well, we need to not turn away from that. And we also need to reach in and hold on to our deepest convictions. We need to find those guideposts that we need as we move through difficult times and difficult conversations with ourselves and with others, as we need help remembering where we're anchored. For me today, this week, there were a couple of anchoring statements that I want to share with you. One is from James Baldwin. You may have seen this. He wrote, "The children are always ours, every single one of them, all over the globe. And I'm beginning to suspect," he wrote, "that whoever is incapable of recognizing this may be incapable of morality." And the Reverend Dr. Sophia Betancourt, our new president of the Unitarian Universalist Association, sent out a pastoral prayer. Part of it reads this way: "I pray for the people of Israel and Palestine, and for leaders around the globe who must respond to this latest flare of violence and the untenable ethical considerations. I pray for us too, less likely to know the trauma of unending brutality and harm, and I pray that we will not turn away. Let us center ourselves in justice as we call for peace." Let us rest for just a moment in the not quite silence we make together.
ask you to take two breaths. One, to hold that in, that peace, that beauty, and our prayers for the world. And a second breath, to shift gears. Our reading is called In the Bathtub Between the Sheets. It's a commentary about UUism's seven principles by the amazing Reverend Meg Barnhouse, and it was published more than a dozen years ago, before the UU eighth principle was drafted and began to be adopted by many UU congregations, including ours. Here is In the Bathtub Between the Sheets. I have gone to a lot of church services in my time. Yes, I could have written this. Oh, I love this. When I was eight, wearing Mary Jane shoes, well, not me, but okay, Mary Jane shoes and white stockings in a blue coat with a velvet collar my mom made me, sitting next to my little sister, trying not to wiggle in my pew, I would make check marks as the sections of the order of worship finished. Hymn number one, check. Pastoral prayer, check. Scripture reading, sermon, I loved checking off the sermon. Not yours. We colored in our bulletins and looked through the hymnals and made ourselves giggle by adding Between the Sheets to their titles. A Baptist friend says she and her friend added In the Bathtub. Turn back, O man, between the sheets. We three kings of Orient are in the bathtub. Years ago, I came into this Unitarian Universalist community of faith, and I'm home. I listen to people talk sometimes about liberal religion as if it's a thin gruel watered down to please everyone. Our seven principles, they complain, are either too much like a creed or so general as to be meaningless. My experience of the principles is that they are deeply demanding. The first one asks me to affirm and promote the inherent worth and dignity of every person, which means that I can no longer subscribe to the cheerful Calvinist doctrine of the total depravity of human nature. Now I have to struggle with the worth and dignity of people who do unspeakably awful things. Whereas the doctrine of total depravity made that one a no-brainer. I'm supposed to value the democratic process, hearing the voice of everyone equally, allowing everyone to have their say. The UU principles are demanding enough to make me whine. For those who feel that they are thin gruel, I have a suggestion. Let's stick something onto the end of every principle that will stop people from smiling and nodding comfortably as they read. Instead of adding in the bathtub or between the sheets, how about attaching beginning in our homes and our congregation? Whoops, page two.
Thank you for being concerned. You are caring.
Sorry, I thought I'd flip over and find page two. Then we'd be, let me sit back up. Attaching beginning in our homes and congregations. If we did that, we'd be faced with affirming things like the goal of peace, liberty, and justice for all, beginning in our homes and congregations. Everyone who has raised children knows that peace is often at odds with liberty, and that justice demands a disturbance of peace. To put those three together in one principle is outrageous and lovely. It's easier to think about working towards them in a global context, it's easier that way, than in a context of Cheerios and pajamas, car keys, and cleaning up one's teenage bedroom. Justice, equity, and compassion in human relations, beginning in our homes and congregations, is a sobering ideal. I don't know about you, but I have sat in meetings about right relations and seen people get testy with one another. Some of the nastiest behavior I've seen was long ago at a community workshop for peace activists. Lao Tzu, quoted in the back of our hymn book, says, "Peace in the world begins with peace in the home, which begins with peace in the heart." If I start with my own heart, the demands of our principles get even heavier. Peace and compassion in my heart, justice too, freedom as well, affirming the worth of every person all the time, not only with my words and my behavior, but within my secret heart. For me, the heart of the liberal faith is to be connected to something greater than yourself, to wallow in the spirit of life, love, and truth, to have fair trade coffee and important conversations, to stand for love and to stand against quibbling and complaining and flouncing off in a huff, to move toward being in right relationship with ourselves, one another, and the planet. Oh, for me, this faith isn't a thin gruel. It's not even a rich and hearty gruel. It's not gruel. It's walnuts and bananas, pancakes, mangoes, arugula, ginger, and avocado. The feast is prepared with effort, enjoyment, persistence, commitment. Care to join me?
Is a poem. When someone deeply listens to you, it is like holding out a dented cup that you've had since childhood and watching it fill with fresh, cold water. When it balances on the top of the brim, you are understood. When it overflows and touches your skin, you are loved. When someone deeply listens to you, your bare feet are on the earth, and a beloved land that seemed distant is now at home within you. I first heard that poem, written by John Fox, many years ago in the Unitarian Universalist Church where I was a member in Yarmouth, Maine. I have no recollection of who said it or what the service was about, but I kind of remember in my body how I felt when I heard those words. Was something like freedom, maybe exhilaration, and kind of all mixed up strangely with grief. Like I wanted to weep or shout or laugh. And among other things, that poem gave me a chance to notice how infrequently I have felt that way in my life, completely seen and heard. It's complicated, too, because a sense both that I am seen and heard and accepted for what I am, and in that clear seeing, somehow that more is expected of me, that the place, the community where I belong, not only loves me, but believes in me. maybe more than I believe in myself. That's what I want to talk to you about this morning. Why are we here? What are we about religiously and in covenant with one another? 3 weeks ago, in part one of this small, short series, I gave you just a little bit of the history and background of religion and how it's developed, that long ago the idea was that God was beyond, completely beyond humanity's even understanding, much less access. So we human beings needed special interpreters to guide us. And then, after a whole bunch of time went by, Martin Luther said, nope, you can actually read scripture yourself, thanks to the press, Gutenberg's, and you can pray and connect with God directly. Now, Luther thought, and lots of other people who came after him, thought that we still needed special people to interpret all of this, which is why a whole bunch of churches with very high pulpits got built. The idea was that the word was coming down from God, maybe, but through the minister. And that kept on changing in Western culture and to some extent around the world too, in this idea that the work of figuring things out, even ultimate things, what people are supposed to do, we can actually do that. Not just by reading the Bible, but by thinking and acting and being with one another. Many religions have moved in this direction, Unitarian Universalism farther than most, perhaps. And our principles, the seven principles, the eighth principles, other guideposts that we find, are our guidelines. And we need them. And we need to make them real in our homes and congregations. So, what is this congregation thing? And why does it matter? Is it just convenient because you need to be reminded once a week? Is that all we can forget about each other in between? Is there anything special that happens in a congregation? I have been wondering about that since I signed the membership book in Yarmouth in 1986, which is frighteningly close to 40 years ago. And over all these years of being a minister, I have paid more and more attention to this sense, this idea, this power of belonging that can happen within the community of a congregation, especially a religious community of any kind. And I'm convinced of this not because such powerful experiences happen often or even that we're very good at it. But I've come to believe that experiencing a sense of belonging to one another and through that to something that is much larger than any of us is a big part of what congregations can do and maybe what we're for. A wise person once said, more than once, that religious community is a place where we get to practice being human. Now, this may seem rather self-focused. We're here to make the world a better place, right? Not just to be happier or better people. But I think to practice being fully human means diving into our inherent worth and dignity, right? Our inherent capacities to be good, to be loving and open-minded and open-hearted, starting with ourselves. Goodness knows the world could use more of that kind of humanity. And goodness knows that we could use the practice. 24 years ago, in a couple of weeks, on October 3rd, 1999, two congregations where I belonged, my home church in Yarmouth and the small, new, five-year-old congregation in southern Rhode Island where I was serving, together ordained me to the Unitarian Universalist ministry. Ordinations are, as you probably know, how many of you have been to ordinations? Okay, so you know that it's as close as we get to high church. There are gifts, there are litanies, the voices of the leaders and the people and the new minister are heard, their processions and promises and admonitions and the ritual laying on of hands. Lots and lots of clergy
wearing all of our best vestments, tons of music, everything but incense. On that day of my ordination, I knew something about the job of being a minister, or at least acting like one. And I knew on that day that I had no real idea of what was going to be expected of me, or where I would find the strength and the energy and the faith and the inspiration that people would need me to have. And I didn't even know which people I was talking about when I thought about that, because I was about to leave the small congregation in Rhode Island and I'd already left the Yarmouth Church. So all those gathered people on the day of my ordination, all pressing down and on my shoulders and lifting me up, they represented somehow all the other people who would expect me to be human in coming years. And that a bunch, or in my case, several different bunches of people in different congregations would believe in me, which was the only way that I might be able to believe in myself. This very interesting alchemy that happens. Our regular rituals on Sundays and other days are less elaborate, but maybe they mean the same thing, that we are part, all of us, of a web of faith and love that will not let us down and will not let us go. It's important to lift up the more complicated reality frequently that belonging to one another begins with remembering that though there's a lot that unites us, we are not all the same. Everyone here is not like-minded. Take a breath. Take that in. It's true. As much as we might imagine it, we are not all like-minded. And everyone here, it's not like just like you. Belonging to one another, being in community, involves accepting and embracing our differences, as well as our similarities, and accepting the extraordinary gift of a chance to practice that acceptance. This is, as we know, an unusual thing in this time of separateness. People in America are segregated by our generations, our ethnicities, our socioeconomic groups and education levels and ideologies. We used to believe that it was possible to avoid identifying people by their religious or political loyalties. Remember when the only rule was you just couldn't talk about politics or religion, and then you could just all get, it all seemed so quaint. Life in America has become uncomfortably and unhealthfully and unhealthily stiffened into our different separate boxes. In many ways, congregations intentionally defy those rules of separateness, partly because generations get all mixed up, which is a lovely thing, but more than that, UU congregations on purpose do not have entrance requirements or a creed defining who can be here. We don't even limit participation to those who've signed the book or made a pledge. We ask one another not to believe in any certain way, but to honor and to try to live according to the principles, our own principles, and the ones we share with Unitarian Universalism. Many UU congregations recite a version of an affirmation of faith which sounds like this: love is the spirit of this church and service is its law. Is this familiar to any of you? This is our great covenant, it goes on, to dwell together in peace, seek the truth in love, and to help one another. It is beautiful, it is bold, and it is absolutely impossible to enforce. So right here, right now, you could be sitting next to a person who doesn't look like you, or think like you, or vote like you, doesn't shop where you shop, or share exactly your moral convictions or questions, who doesn't pray like you pray or don't pray. Not so long ago in our churches, it was enough to be tolerant, with a capital T. In the mid-20th century, freedom, reason, and tolerance were what Unitarianism proclaimed as our most important principles. But if you think about it, tolerance actually works best at arm's length. And it can be expressed through politeness alone. Tolerance even allows judgment as long as it's private. And then in the 1960s, the Unitarians merged with the Universalists, who preached a more inclusive theology, and we ended up with that first principle that Liam was talking about, the inherent worth and dignity of every person. Tolerance didn't cut it anymore. We need to practice this belonging to one another in spite of our real differences. Because we cannot do what we're called to do all by ourselves. I actually think that the most challenging of our principles is the third one. Don't look it up in your hymnal, but you'll remember it when I say it. The third principle affirms and promotes that we accept one another and encourage one another to spiritual growth in our congregation. If you think about it, that is an amazing thing. My dear friend, the Reverend Chris Long, whose work is racial justice ministry, says that's the only principle that we need to pay attention to when we're trying to do justice work. To start with accepting one another and encouraging one another, not to agree with us, but to become more than they already have become in their lives. Thirteen years before my ordination, when I became a member in Yarmouth, I made a deal with myself that I would be in charge of, how involved I was going to be. That I would be in the choir and I would come to worship and do nothing else. I would absolutely not be on any committees. When a friend asked me to run for the board in that congregation, I said, no. No, I was busy. I had a plan for my life. My children needed me. I had an inkling of why he asked, of what I might be able to do for my church, and I did care. I didn't yet know, though, what that church could do for me, and in a way, with me and to me. Here's why I didn't keep my deal. Because when people asked me to do more, they believed that I could do something effectively that I didn't yet know how to do. That's an extraordinary thing. Have you ever been asked and expected and welcomed to do something that isn't already in your toolbox? That isn't something that you're confident about? That's really quite an extraordinary moment. I don't know how to do that, and yet this person whom I care about thinks I can. So maybe that's possible. Maybe it is. So the point is that the values and the promises of a shared religious community, when we articulate them and let them in, call all of us to become something more, something new, something challenging. And I've come to believe that that's why we're here together, in this place where we can belong as the persons you are and the more fully human persons you might become. And in that community, that's where the divine, God, the Holy Spirit, the place where goodness is not only possible but real, shows up just like God who came to Sophia's party without actually showing up exactly. Sets a pretty high bar, I know, to assert that our congregations will be a place of that kind of cultivating of spiritual growth. We fail all the time, and yet we still believe in one another, or can believe in one another, that we can do this. One person's, sorry, let me skip that. The remarkable thing is that we do keep coming back. We keep trying to get it right. In our congregations, we catch a glimpse of something better, and if we're encouraged, we keep dreaming, not about how wonderful it used to be, but about what else might be possible. I will end with the words of the Reverend Mark Morrison Reed, who says, "This is the central task of the worshiping community, to invite the spiritual presence, to unveil the connectedness of all humanity through the story of life, a relationship discovered amid the particulars of our own lives and the lives of others. Once felt, it inspires us to act for justice. But the religious community is essential, for alone our vision is too narrow to see all that must be seen, and our power too limited to do all that must be done. Together, our vision widens and our strength is renewed. So may it be. So may it blessed be. And let us sing. May you find shelter in being seen for who you are, and may you find hope in this place. May you find hope in this place, and may you go forth knowing that you are a blessing to this world, even if you're still finding out some of the ways that that's true. Know that you are a blessing. Know that you are good. Know that the world needs you. Is this where I'm supposed to do my little introduction? Okay. So the postlude, which the choir is about to bless you with, is the song Lean on Me. Yeah, good idea. When I lived in West Virginia, I learned something about this song that I've always loved that maybe you would like to know too. Bill Withers was West Virginian, he was African American, and his family, like lots of African American families in West Virginia, had many of them had worked in coal mines. And when he wrote this song, Lean on Me, Let Me Know If You Need Help, he was talking about coal miners. And what he said was, when anybody comes out of a coal mine, they're all the same color. So I wanted you to know that as you hear the song today, as you sing it, and as you hear it in the future, that was what Bill Withers wanted us to know from singing the song.